The Relation of Consciousness and Object in Sense Perception by Evander Bradley McGilvary. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Footnote: An abstract of this paper was read at the 11th annual meeting of the American Philosophical Association in Cambridge, December 27, 1911. End footnote. In the paper, I propose to discuss both the connected but discriminable questions which our Committee on Definitions has proposed. The answer that I shall give to the first question is the one which the Committee has formulated as follows: that perceived objects are sometimes real and sometimes not real, and real objects are sometimes perceived and sometimes not perceived, which here signifies not given in any actual perception. This means that the real object and the perceived object are at the moment of perception numerically one, and that the real object may exist at other moments apart from any perception. The view thus formulated the committee calls epistemological monism and realism. The answer I shall give to the second question is that consciousness is a unique and not further analyzable relation of togetherness, which obtains among all the objects given in the momentary, individuated, and limited field of any particular perception. Both of these answers I have defended elsewhere, and I will take this occasion to show more fully than I have yet done how the answer given to the second question is logically related to the answer given to the first. But in doing this, I wish also to develop further both the connected views. All this can perhaps best be done by making constant reference to criticisms that have appeared in the papers mentioned in the committee's bibliography. It would have saved time if I could have accepted the committee's formulation of epistemological monistic realism without qualification or comment, but as I cannot do this, I shall ask the indulgence of being allowed to qualify and comment. In the first place, I should like to soften down the dogmatism of the committee's formulation. I should be loath to say that idealism in each and all of its forms is false. There appear to be serious flaws in all the arguments advanced for idealism, but of course a flaw in an argument is not a proof of the falsity of the conclusion. Idealism is not demonstrably false. Its chief offense is that it claims to be the only tenable theory of the universe, and the only theory that can give the business of morality a genuine enablement. Both claims seem to be unfounded. On the other hand, the difficulties of realism are not slight. My advocacy of realism here is not to be attributed to any belief that realism is demonstrably true, but to the fact that many of the difficulties alleged to be insuperable on any realistic theory have seemed to yield in face of more searching analysis, and many others do not appear now quite so hopelessly formidable as they did at first. All this gives to realism the character of a promising working hypothesis. My position here is frankly that of an advocate who undertakes to defend a client, whose case he has taken up because, having had occasion to look into it, he has found that many counts in the indictment against the defendant are supported by infamously weak testimony. The case is now up for a hearing, and all I ask is the Scotch verdict. If the jury will render that, his friends will do the rest. In the second place, the term object has been defined by the committee as any complex of physical qualities, whether perceived or unperceived and whether real or unreal. I wish to ask leave of you to suggest another definition and make this the basis of interpretation for what I shall have to say. By object is meant any quality or any relation, however abstractly taken. Suppose the case under consideration to be the perception of an orange. Now, what is the perceived object here? The orange color, the hemisphericity, the continuity of surface, is each one of these things a perceived object? Or is there only one perceived object constituted by the named qualities and relations together with such others as may characterize the perceived orange? Now a realist, using the term object abstractly, may be disposed to say that some specified perceived object is numerically one with the real object, and that some other specified perceived object is not numerically one with the real object. Such a realist must say, when both these abstractly taken perceived objects are regarded as entering into the constitution of a concrete perceived object, that this concrete perceived object is not numerically one with the concrete real object. There are numerically two objects, each with its complement of qualities and relations, although each shares with the other some identical qualities and relations. If then by perceived object be meant the concrete perceived object, and by real object be meant the concrete real object, I should have to class myself with the epistemological dualists. And yet in that class I find myself in as strange company and as ill at ease therein as a bald-headed goose in the company of bald-headed men. If, however, by perceived object be meant any quality or any relation that is perceived, then I can class myself in the congenial company of epistemological monists. The atoning consciousness of kind is a complacency that fortifies me against the charge of common silliness. Let us now proceed to the specifications in that charge. 1. The first argument I shall consider has been urged against epistemologically monistic realism by those with whom I am in agreement as to the nature of consciousness. Mr. Miller and Mr. Drake, while regarding consciousness as being a unique kind of togetherness of objects, maintain that just because consciousness is exactly this kind of thing, the real object can never be perceived. If they are correct on this point, then my view is logically untenable, and there is no need of trying to develop it further. Try to suppose, says Mr. Miller, a content X, the real object, in two minds or fields, one of which contains also the private content A, and the second of which contains also the private content B. Joint presentation or empirical conjunction, that which constitutes a field, is a relation between contents. Now in field number one, X, the real object, stands in a relation of conjunction with A, while in field number two, it does not stand in that relation, A being left outside. So the result is that the same content, the real object, at the same time, does and does not stand in a certain relation to another. Put this way, realism does seem to have made a mess of it. It ought to have followed Mr. Miller's logical recipe, and the result would have been a delicious pudding. But the best proof of a pudding is the eating of it. Let us see how one of these puddings tastes. In the field of the American Philosophical Association, Mr. Miller stands in a relation of conjunction with me, while in that of the Western Philosophical Association he does not stand in that relation, being left outside by his own choice. So the result is that the same content at the same time does and does not stand in a certain relation to another, the relation being, of course, that of fellow membership in philosophical associations. Being a contradiction in terms, the alleged facts stated above cannot be true, and our published membership lists are egregiously illogical. Here, then, is a sample of Mr. Miller's logical puddings. If you like it, you are welcome to my share. 2. Mr. Miller and Mr. Drake find another difficulty in the combination of epistemological monism with realism. The desk is a light brown total or unit, says Mr. Miller. The desk is a complex combination of drawers and compartments to the right and left. The desk is a wilderness of woody fiber. The desk, if you will, as a host of ordered molecules or atoms, are different desks and will in no wise go together. If we could bring in all sides and features of the object, we should not have a desk but a monstrous melody. The incompatibility is logical. A continuous polished brown surface is not a fibrous or granulated surface. A marshalling of what we scientifically mean by molecules is not what we familiarly mean by a desk. Now, I have found it hard to locate the logical difficulty which Mr. Miller is trying to point out to me. For a long time I took it to be in the fact that so many qualities and parts must be considered by realism as uniting to form one desk. But the more I reflect on this interpretation of Mr. Miller's polemic, the more reluctant am I to believe that this is what he can have meant. It would be too inconsistent of such a logician to mean it. For he himself has said that one looks across the room, and at a single moment of one's looking, certain portions of the wall, the rug, the table, the sofa, are conjoined. They are, as the phrase is, in one consciousness. This whole empirical complex of any moment, as I understand Mr. Miller, is a single state or field of consciousness. Now, if such different things as a portion of wall, room, rug, and sofa can actually combine into a single state of consciousness without logical transgression, I do not see how Mr. Miller could have had the unfairness to assert that drawers and compartments to right and left woody fiber, and, if you will, a host of molecules and atoms cannot in their own way unite to form a single desk. Is a desk bound to be more purely logical in its unity than a state of consciousness? I have not found anywhere else in Mr. Miller's writings any indication of his holding that while the material world is obliged at all hazards to obey the laws of such a rigid logic, the world of consciousness may disregard the laws of logic in its formation and yet be without sin. This is Bergson's view, but then in Bergson it is combined with a depreciation of logic as a speculative instrument. Again, Mr. Miller cannot have wished to emphasize the connotation of the word mean in the sentence. A marshaling of what we specifically mean by molecules is not what we familiarly mean by a desk, so as to find the contradiction of realism in the confusion of two entirely different conceptions. This would be parallel to saying that what we mean by color is not what we mean by shape, and therefore the same thing cannot be both yellow and round. Such a refutation of realism would be too utterly trifling to have been possibly Mr. Miller's argument. So far as I can see, then, there is only one sentence in the whole passage from which the quotation about the desk is taken in which any appearance of logical inconsistency is pointed out. A continuous polished brown surface is not a fibrous or granulated surface. And even here, the brownness of the surface does not seem to be in contradiction to anything, unless we are to suppose that the fibers or the grains are not brown while the surface as a whole is brown. Now, it is quite true that when the grains are taken small enough, as science does take them, calling them molecules and atoms and alpha particles, realism may follow the scientists in supposing that these particles are uncolored. But then realism is not committed to such a taking. But even if it were, what logic is there to rule out the possibility that parts of real things do not have qualities that wholes do have? Such a possibility seems to be realized in many aesthetic objects, as for example in a melody or a harmony. Why may not physical wholes share the privilege that certain experienced wholes possess? If they may, then the brownness of a group of uncolored atoms is not anti-logical, unless the melodic quality of a series of notes, not one of which by itself is melodic, is anti-logical. It must not be considered as an objection to this suggestion that the color of the combination varies from time to time. There is nothing in the type of realism here advocated that commits it to the maintenance of the immutability of real qualities. The physical universe may, on the realistic theory, be conceived as varying in every respect in which it can be shown with any plausibility that it does vary, and as constant in every respect in which it can be shown to be constant. The predilection of critical realism for an allegiance with a qualitatively unchanging physical universe must not be imputed to all realisms. But what about the polish and continuity of a surface which is also fibrous or granulated? Here we have many real difficulties, but the formal difficulties insisted on by Mr. Miller can be easily surmounted by any realist who admits that some perceived characteristics are not real. He can simply say that the perceived continuity is unreal and exists only in consciousness, not in the material world. This is the way in which common sense, both naive and systematized, meets the difficulty. The perceived continuity of red in the blood is thus said to be only a way in which we, with our macroscopic vision, see what is really the discontinuous redness of discrete corpuscles. But I am not sure that this is the only way, or even the best way, out of the difficulty. The subject of continuity is very intricate, and needs much more analysis than has as yet been given to it. In this case, it is complicated with many other questions, such as that of the nature of impenetrability, and that of qualities which certain wholes may have but parts do not. Further, any definitive conclusion cannot be reached till questions as to the atomic constitution of the material world have been settled, if they ever be settled. In short, realism as a philosophy leaves open all the questions of fact that science in any of its special branches is now busied with. It is neither compelled nor disposed to deny any fact that is made out about the material world. It simply is more generous in its ascriptions of quality in relation to the real world. 3. But suppose that, for the time, pending many conclusions, a realist were to say that the perceived continuity of colored surfaces is a continuity in space, and in real space, though it is a continuity that exists only in consciousness, not in the material world. He is now met by Mr. Lovejoy with a logical veto. In fact, formal logic exercises very freely these days its constitutional privilege of the veto against insurgent realism. Its wisdom in so doing remains to be seen. More than once in the past, its indiscretions have served only to bring it into disrepute. In hallucinations, illusions, and even mere errors, then, says Mr. Lovejoy, we have instances in which the meaning of an object's being in consciousness cannot be expressed in terms congruous with the relational theory. Mr. Lovejoy seems to think that if anything is denied a place in the material world, it must be taken out of real space. The major premise which he employs to reach this conclusion is that the same portion of real space cannot be at once both empty and filled. I shall now attempt to show that this premise contains a most insidious equivocation. Empty space may be space which is void of material objects, or space which is void of immaterial objects, or space void of both. A space may be void of material objects, and filled with some immaterial objects, or even many of them, or vice versa. Or a space may even be filled with both a material and an immaterial object. This, of course, sounds hopelessly scholastic to many of you, but many scholastic insights have been discarded, not because they were false in principle, but because they were wrongly applied under the dominance of the scholastic conception of a soul substance. Philosophical conceptions, as well as their human hosts, may have their good manners corrupted by evil communications. If you will only indulge me for a few moments, meanwhile keeping your anti-scholastic prejudices in abeyance long enough to give me a fair hearing, I will undertake to make good this particular scholastic principle, whose reputation has been deservedly besmirched by its previous bad behavior. I will try to show that the immediate facts of experience support this principle, and that logic is not against it. Let us take just one case. Look into a hand mirror which you are holding to your face. You see an image in the space behind the mirror. Reach one hand behind the mirror, and you feel the wall in the place where you see the image. So far as the immediate facts of that experience go, the image is seen to be just where the wall is felt to be. Each is in space, in the same space, and in the same place in that space. But you retort that the one is in visual space, and the other in tactual space. I can only reply that if your experience is like mine under the conditions named, what you say is not a statement of immediately experienced fact, but of a certain theory which you have accepted about these facts. That theory may be true or false, but I cannot see how it can be shown to be true unless the facts as immediately experienced can be shown to be self-contradictory. Your theory forces you to recognize two spaces when there is only one space actually experienced. As a theory, it has many other difficulties besides. I do not say that these difficulties cannot be successfully met, but is it not wise to decline to meet difficulties that you can more easily avoid than meet? Into these difficulties I cannot go here. They are at least as great as most of the difficulties that are found in realism, and many of the difficulties that have been found in realism have first been imported into it on the back of this theory of yours. But let us return to the immediately experienced facts, and try to see whether we may not state these facts in realistic fashion, without making ourselves justly liable to the charge of logical inconsistency. In the first place, our realism does not try to classify the facts under the traditional rubrics real and apparent, mutually opposed and exclusive. In the second place, it does classify them under two very different rubrics, material and immaterial, or, if you prefer the committee's terminology, real and unreal. But it must be remembered that real or material and unreal or immaterial do not have obvious significations, incapable of being misunderstood. To define the real as the material and then to define the material as the space occupying leads nowhere if space occupancy be itself ambiguous. Footnote: I will suggest a definition of material and immaterial before I have done with this problem, and it is in accordance with this definition that I shall ask you to interpret the terms real and unreal in this paper, these latter terms having by the committee been made practically synonymous with the terms material and immaterial. End footnote. In the third place, in dealing with the facts experienced or perceived when looking into the mirror, I merely try to discover what are actually the relations perceived as obtaining between image, hand, and wall, and I distinguish what I find to be different relations. Upon the basis of these distinctions, I construct my realistic statement, and my holding fast to the distinctions saves me, I think, from logical inconsistency. Now let us see what are the relations we can thus distinguish. There are several that are pertinent to our present inquiry. First, there is the relation of spatial externality that obtains between my hand and the wall. But I do not find that my hand is spatially external to the image. The image is seen to be where my hand is felt to be. If I move my head backward from the mirror, the image recedes into the place where the wall is felt by my hand to be. The second relation I discover on analysis is that of spatial monopolization obtaining between hand and wall. I cannot put my hand into the wall, i.e. into the place where the wall is, whereas I can put the image into either place by the proper movement of my head. Then there is the relation of movement, or if you prefer to put it another way, the change of relation involved in movement, the consideration of which would take us into the question of time. Then, over and above all these relations, there is the fact of space occupancy or spatial position, upon the purely relational character of which I should not wish here to commit myself. It is a difficult problem, which would take too much time now to discuss. Now, if spatial monopolization be a relation that obtains among certain objects perceived, and not among certain other objects perceived, although all these objects are perceived as spatially located, why not accept this as a fact, instead of doubling our space, and calling one of the resultant spaces consciousness? There is no logical incompatibility in the fact that some objects exclude some other objects from the place where they are, while they do not exclude all other objects. If we thus take the facts as they present themselves in experience without re-editing them, we need not consider impenetrability as a universal characteristic of space-occupying objects, any more than commercial monopolization need be accepted as a universal characteristic of business corporations. The dogma of the impenetrability of all objects in space is a generalization from a part of our experiences, and is made in defiance of other experienced facts. And it is only after you have accepted this dogma that logic forces you to go no further and regard the facts that contradict your dogma as not being in real space. Logic does not force anyone to admit that, if any space is filled by something, nothing else except this occupant can be in that space at the same time. We must first define what is meant by filled, before the law of contradiction can be applied to any statement in which this term occurs. For instance, when we say that we have filled a glass full of water, the law of contradiction does not tell us that we cannot put any sugar into it. For a glass full of water may mean a glass that holds all the water that can be put into it under given conditions. Not logic, but observation and experiment can determine whether something else than water can be put into a glass full of water. So again, a dinner pail may be declared to be empty, without danger that a logic that knows its business will step in and draw from the statement the conclusion that there is no air in the pail. Now, in like manner, the realist does not think that he is fairly treated when his admission that a space is filled with a material object is used as a premise to force upon him the conclusion that that space cannot contain or receive, along with this material object, some immaterial object or any number of such objects, because, forsooth, the same portion of real space cannot be at once both filled and empty. The realist may try as hard as anyone else not to contradict himself, and like other persons, he may fail. But he should not be held responsible for illogicalities of which he is not guilty. Mr. Lovejoy's criticism is thus shown to be based upon a misunderstanding of the realistic position. This misunderstanding is natural enough in view of the fact that realism has not gone very much into the detail of exposition. In order to remove Mr. Lovejoy's misunderstanding, I will here attempt to give a very brief sketch of my realistic Weltanschauung, so far as it concerns the spatial relation of the material world to immaterial things. A sketch very brief, partly because I would have no time for anything else here, and partly because I should not be able to fill in the sketch at more than a few points, even if I had the time. The space that is given in any perception is only a portion of one space which extends out in three dimensions, presumably without limits. In this space there are some objects which are impenetrable, but this impenetrability is relative only to certain other objects in this space. So far from being a universal characteristic of space-occupying objects, impenetrability is not only a characteristic of only some space-occupying objects, but it is also a characteristic of these objects only in relation to some other space-occupying objects, not in relation to all other space-occupying objects. Those objects that stand in this mutual relation of impenetrability I call material objects. All other objects are immaterial. Footnote: according to this definition, the problematic ether is immaterial, if its nature as continuous is correctly conceived by physical science. Its continuity involves its sharing with material objects and immaterial objects such portions of space as they occupy. I should, however, call it a physical object, because if it does exist, it shares with material objects the common characteristic of not having to be a term of a consciousness relation. It may, in other words, exist outside of consciousness. It succeeds very well in keeping outside all the time. To exist outside of consciousness is to be in space and time, and yet not to be a term of some consciousness relation. Since writing what precedes, Mr. Morris R. Cohen has kindly brought to my attention the following passage from an article by Lord Kelvin. "It has occurred to me that without contravening anything we know from observation of nature, we may simply deny the scholastic axiom that two portions of matter cannot jointly occupy the same space, and may assert, as an admissible hypothesis, that ether does occupy the same space as ponderable matter, and that ether is not displaced by ponderable bodies moving through space occupied by ether." End footnote. In thus calling an object immaterial, I am merely recognizing the fact that it is not a space monopolizer. The term material thus does not connote any distinctive quality, but only the distinctive relation of space monopolization in which the material object stands to other material objects. Footnote: on this point, as on so many others, it will seem that I am indebted to William James for the general principle I employ. See the concluding pages of his article, "Does Consciousness Exist?" End footnote. Though material and immaterial objects are not mutually impenetrable, they stand to each other in various other relations, such as priority, likeness, difference, causality, and so on. Among these relations, obtaining between material and immaterial objects is the consciousness relation. Let us now pause a while to examine this relation more closely, before continuing the sketch of a realistic Weltanschauung as far as the contents of space are concerned. Like every other relation, consciousness, when it obtains among objects, constitutes them into a unitary group or complex. Any consciousness complex is an experience. Like many other relational complexes, e.g. a circle, every experience seems to have a unique center of reference. Footnote: many relational complexes do not have such a single and exclusive center of reference. For instance, the distance between Cambridge and Madison is not centered exclusively in either Cambridge or Madison. On the other hand, the relationship which constitutes a patriarchal family or an absolute monarchy is centered in the patriarch or monarch, so that the sovereign could, with much truth, say, "L'état, c'est moi." End footnote. The center of reference of an experience is a material body, or rather such parts of that body as enter into that experience, together with such immaterial things as penetrate that body and are likewise included in that experience, e.g. organic sensations, emotions, etc. Two or more experiences may have the same body as center, as in the case of double personality. Although even here it is probable that a precise identification of the center in either case would not show exact coincidence. In every distinct type of centered relation, the kind of centrality enjoyed by some one or more of its terms is unique. The respective centralities of the center of a circle, of the foci of an ellipse, of the keystone of an arc, of the patriarch of a clan, of the boss of a political machine, of the hero of a story, of the idea of the good in Plato's world of ideas, is each the peculiar kind of centrality which the peculiar kind of relation in question carries with it. If the relation is a spatial relation, the centrality is spatial. If the relation is social, the centrality is social. If the relation is of the aesthetic type, the centrality is aesthetic. If the relation is consciousness, the centrality is just that unique kind of centrality which we find belonging to those various terms of the consciousness relation, which we call collectively and synthetically the self. As consciousness is a relation between objects in space, we find in experience a spatial perspective which centers in that portion of space the body occupies. Footnote: a more detailed consideration of the centrality of consciousness in its spatial aspect would, I think, show that objections against realism, based on the fact that the same object varies in size with variations of distance from the body, and on similar facts, are not unanswerable. End footnote. As consciousness is a relation between objects in time, we find a temporal perspective centering in that portion of time which the body and its organic sensations occupy. And yet the spatial and temporal centers of experience are not merely spatial and temporal centers. They are spatial and temporal centers of a relational complex, which has a distinctive character given to it by the fact that it is a conscious relational complex. And the spatial and temporal centers of experience get a coloring all their own from the fact that the relation of consciousness constitutes, out of the spatial and temporal terms it organizes, a unique conscious whole. In short, the center of experience is a conscious center. Again, consciousness, like any other relation, and like any quality, exists in individualized instances, and yet each instance is an instance of a kind. Identity of kind is not incompatible with discreteness of instance. Just as the equality of 4 to 2 plus 2 is generically identical with the equality of 9 to 3 times 3, and yet the first equality is just that particular equality which obtains between the quantities in the first equation, and the second is just that particular equality which obtains between the quantities in the second equation, so consciousness is generically one and individually many. Any consciousness is an individualized consciousness. When I say this, I mean not only an individualized consciousness, but also an individualized consciousness. The uniqueness of the consciousness relation in general enters into its individualized instances, so that we have in any individualized consciousness an individuality generically different from that of any other individualized relation. The individuality of consciousness is to be taken just as it is, and not to be washed out till it is indistinguishable from an equally washed out individuality of some other relation. I have dwelt on the centered character of the consciousness relation and the unique individuality of any individualized consciousness, partly because some of the advocates of the relational theory of consciousness have as yet failed to do so, and partly because the opponents of this theory have, as a result, very naturally supposed that this theory involves consequences which it does not involve, consequences which are at variance with facts. To say that consciousness is a relation is not to say much that is worth saying, unless it be followed by saying that consciousness is not a relation überhaupt, but a relation which relates in just the specific way that brings about the specific things that we call our experiences. As I understand the advocates of this theory, they have never meant to stop on the insistence that consciousness is a relation. But the novelty of their contention has brought about a situation in which attention is directed to the general relational character of consciousness, and to some extent diverted from the specific differentiae of the consciousness relation. Let us now return to the consideration of the one space in which are located material and immaterial objects. In this space are experiences, each experience constituted by the fact that an individualized and centered consciousness relation obtains among certain of these objects, material and immaterial. An experience as a uniquely integrated whole of spatial objects has a spatial extension, or if you prefer, a spatial span. But this whole as a conscious whole does not monopolize the space where it is. An experience may be spatially penetrated by some other experience. Your perceptual experiences at this moment of my reading this paper may be in part in the same place in which is my perceptual experience, each experience differently centered, but all partially overlapping in space. In this respect, any consciousness complex is analogous to many other complexes. For instance, I may have on my shelf 24 books, the 16 books to the right being bound in red, the 8 to the left in green, while the 8 to the right are octavos and the 16 to the left are duodecimos. The duodecimo group in this case overlaps the red group. Neither group forfeits its integrity as a group by reason of the fact that part of the space the group occupies is also occupied by the other group. Even so, our experiences spatially penetrate each other. No experience is compelled to contract its spatial bulk because some other experience is going to elbow its way into it. There is no crowding as of angels on a needle's point. Each experience has all the room it takes and shares as much room with its fellows as they need. Footnote: but this spatial interpenetration is not to be used as a premise for a telepathic conclusion. Whether telepathy is a fact or not may or may not be open to discussion. Only facts can decide. But the logic that would deduce telepathy from the statements made in the paragraph above could also as well infer that when a number of men stroll through a thicket, the bushes intervening between their legs become parties to the human fellowship. With Walt Whitman in the party, the bushes probably would. But that would be because Whitman was Whitman, not merely because the bushes happened to be there. End footnote. Thus we have in the one space one actual world of a vastness and complexity incomprehensible in detail. Of this one world, the material world is a part. Every immaterial object is a part, and every experience is a part. There are worlds within worlds, each with a unity of its own, each with some interconnection with some other world. The different worlds in space are different, not because each is in a space all its own, but because each is constituted after its own kind by the relations that obtain among its members. And the same members in some cases enter into different worlds. The material world, your world, my world, and the worlds of your cat and my dog. 4. Let us now pass to the time problem, so far as it can be treated here, and before taking up the special difficulty which has so often been thrown down as a gauntlet to realism, let me make one or two general remarks on the subject of time. Just as the realist declines to accept impenetrability as a universal characteristic of space-occupying objects, so would he reject one interpretation of the old truism, ex nihilo, nihil fit. So far as this principle is intended to exclude novelty, it is repudiated. New things are constantly occurring, and among these new things the realist would include new qualities of material objects. Some constancies obtain, and some novelties arise. Just how much of either is not to be determined, a priori. The realist is willing to accept just as much permanence as can be established, and is willing even to assume more, but he is not willing to generalize to the sweeping conclusion that matter in all its qualities is unchangeable. Immaterial things likewise, such as pain, come and go. They come no whence and go no whither. They have their antecedents, but they are not their antecedents. And so with consciousness. It supervenes, but when it does, it comes as a novelty. Just as when two objects come to resemble each other by changes they undergo, the similarity that arises is not an eternal similarity that has migrated from eternity into time to take up a temporary sojourn. It was not, it is, and it will not be. We may discover its causes, but we do not find it in its causes, we find its causes. On such a view, the appearance of an hallucinatory object evidently is not properly describable as the momentary entrance of a real and perduring spatial thing, unless it can be shown that it had existed before it entered. But its lack of perdurance is no more evidence of its not being where it is when it is perceived than its penetrability is evidence that it is not there. That object was not before it was perceived, although its causes were. It ceases, it is annihilated, when it ceases to be perceived, but its effects endure, changing as they go. Let us now address ourselves to the special time problem which is so acutely felt by many when the question arises. How can we now perceive a star that for aught we know may have been extinct for 1,000 years? But I should first like to ask another question. How can I here in this part of space perceive something out yonder? To this question, Mr. Miller gives what seems to me the true answer. He says that we recognize that the object is external to ourselves, but external to ourselves does not mean external to our consciousness, but external to our bodies, primarily and secondarily, distinct from our feelings and ideas. Now, why not give the same kind of answer to the question how we now can know a star which existed 1,000 years ago? Such an answer would run, the star is indeed prior to ourselves, but prior to ourselves does not mean prior to our consciousness, but prior to our bodies primarily and secondarily to our feelings and ideas. So far as I can see, there are two obstacles to the acceptance of this answer. The one is intellectualistic, the other empirical. The intellectualistic objection holds as well against the generally accepted solution of the space problem of perception just referred to. But I will not discuss this objection till it is pressed. The empirical objection is based on the fact that the star is not experienced as prior to my body and its feelings in the same way in which the object out there in space is experienced as external to my body. This is indeed at first sight a most serious objection, and unless it can be met, realism will be in a precarious position. It will be in just as precarious a position in face of this problem as any other theory which recognizes the facts that constitute the problem. Now, before I suggest a solution of this problem from a realistic point of view, let me call attention to the fact that this time difficulty is only one of a type. Two flashes may be perceived as synchronous, although we may have good reason to suppose that if we had experienced them in all their time relations, we should have experienced them as successive. So in space, we may not experience the two points of a compass pricking our back as spatially external to each other, although if we had experienced them in their full complement of space relations, we should have experienced them as mutually external. I bring in these additional difficulties, not because I wish to make an inexplicability seem less an inexplicability because it is only one of many, but because the accumulation of similar perplexities may suggest some means of removing them all. The comparison of all such cases as these suggests that something of the complexity of the temporal and spatial relations in which real objects stand to each other has been left out when they enter into experience. Now, what theory of consciousness could better be adapted to deal with this kind of difficulty than the very theory that consciousness is a way certain objects have of being together, and that when objects come together in this way, some of the qualities and relations of these objects are not taken into the union constituted by consciousness? When it comes to the making of experience, some things are taken and others are left. Why should not just those relations be left out, whose function it is to distance their terms from one another in space and time? The relational view of consciousness thus seems to enable us to deal with our specific problem in a very simple way, and this way is at bottom the old naively realistic way which the plain man and the scientist take when they say, things are really thus and so, but we do not see them as they are. So say I as a plain man, and when I become a plain philosopher, I do not take it back. I merely go on to say that the reason I do not see them as they fully are is that I see them only in part, as through, not in, a glass darkly. An omission from consciousness is not an utterance of consciousness. Now, if this were all that need be said on this matter, the solution proposed would be easy enough. Many would say too easy to be taken seriously. But it is not all, for talk away as much as we please, experience does present us with the star as contemporary with the body. The suppressio veri is a suggestio falsi, then, is it not? And again, if my consciousness spans the time from date of star to date of body, must it not itself be dated as of the millennium 9-11 to 1911? If I could not see this joke, others at any rate would be quick enough to see it. I cannot discuss these points thoroughly here in a paper much too long already. I will merely say that a body and star are contemporary but not simultaneous. Contemporaneity is synchronousness within the same durational unit, whatever that unit may be, e.g. within the same day or year or century. Contemporary philosophy, for instance, is not confined to the present instant. Footnote: I once attended lectures given by Professor McCosh on contemporary philosophy in which modern thought was traced down as far as Plato. Simultaneity, on the other hand, is synchronousness of events whose relative direction inter se runs, as it were, at right angles to the direction of the temporal current. Time has three directions, two of which lie in one dimension. The third direction is non-dimensional. Duration, with its two directions, is dimensional because it can be measured, and position in duration is ordered. In the direction of simultaneity, there is no order, and no intervaled position giving distance can be measured. It would be more correct to say that the third direction in time is the system of directions in the three dimensions of space, and that the order and position in the third direction of time is the spatial order and position. Most correct of all would be to say that time and space are distinct systems of relations within a unitary and comprehensive system of relations, the spatio-temporal system. We do not have time plus space, but space-time and timed space. The full recognition of this fact would guard us from the errors into which Bergson has fallen. Contemporaneity is longitudinal synchronousness. Simultaneity is transverse synchronousness. Applying this distinction to our problem, I would suggest that experience gives us the star as contemporary. In our confusion resulting from lack of analysis, we mistake this contemporaneity for simultaneity. And now as to the date of consciousness. If consciousness were not a uniquely centered relation, there would be no more justification for dating a consciousness which spans 1,000 years at the end of that period than at the beginning. It would be as correct to say that 1,000 years ago I saw that bothersome star as to say that I see it now. But consciousness is centered, and being centered in what is now, it is now and not then that I perceive. Consciousness enjoys a limited transcendence of the date which is central to consciousness. But this transcendence radiates from the present, and is commensurate with the durational span of its object, just as consciousness has a limited ubiquity, likewise radiating from the body's position. The date transcendence of consciousness here maintained is thus not only quantitatively different from the eternity of the absolute consciousness, but also qualitatively different. The absolute consciousness hovers over the infinite stretch of duration, but like Noah's dove, it finds no rest for the sole of its foot. The reason for its failure is not that there is no resting place. There are altogether too many of them. Its plight, therefore, is rather to compare great things with small, and ineffable things with ineffable, that of Mr. Kipling's cat who walks by himself, all places being alike to him. 5. There are still two further questions that I wish to touch upon here, indicating the answers that I should be disposed to give. The first concerns color blindness. Suppose we should say what many psychologists say, that color and brightness are different attributes of sensation. Why then might they not be different real qualities of real things? And why might not, under certain organic conditions, the selective relation of consciousness pick out for one of its terms the brightness and omit the greenness or the redness, just as, under other organic conditions, it omits them both? If consciousness were a selective relation, and if it did select brightness and omit redness, the result would be just like what we find. The theory of consciousness as a unique selective relation, then, seems to work pretty well here, as an hypothesis. The empirical fact that consciousness is a unique way of togetherness seems thus to become a scientific principle for the solution of a most vexed problem. 6. The other question just referred to is that of the consciousness of consciousness. I discussed this question some years ago, and then I gave what I now admit to be an erroneous statement of what I am still convinced is an actual fact. You might as well try to persuade me that I do not see red when I do see it, as persuade me that at times in perception there is nothing more than just perception of objects. In my former discussion, I connected the failure to recognize this something more with non-attention to it. I did not go far enough. I should have said that the fact not attended to is the fact of attention itself. Attention is, in one of its aspects, a certain prominence that any constituent of experience has as compared with some other constituent. Footnote: another characteristic of an attentive experience is the presence in such experience of kinesthetic sensations. There are still other characteristics. End footnote. It is thus itself a certain unique relation which, when it obtains among factors of experience, gives a peculiar outstandingness to some factor. When it does so obtain, this attentional prominence is not the fact that something is out of gear. It is the fact it seems to be, namely, the fact that some constituent of experience has an unanalyzable eminence over its mates. Its relation to the objective gearing of things would take us into the question of the relation of consciousness to organ. Now, among the things that may thus stand out prominent in an attentional way in any experience are relations. For instance, I may be attentive to the similarity of objects rather than to the objects themselves. But if in an experience the relations between objects may and do have attentional prominence, why may not consciousness, which is a relation among objects, also have like attentional prominence? As a matter of fact, at times in my experience it does. For instance, when I am forced to contrast the relation of the objects conjoined to each other with the opposing relation between objects not conjoined, in this conscious way, it may be the present conjunction of objects in my present experience which I contrast with the fact that this sort of conjunction does not now obtain between this sheet of paper and a houseboat on the Ma Nam. I cannot but think that it is because all of us have been looking for a thing wrongly described as a consciousness of consciousness, that we have not found what is actually there at times in our perception. We have tried to find consciousness which is related to itself in the same way in which objects are related to each other by consciousness. If, instead of doing this, we look for a way in which consciousness is related to its object, the way of attentional prominence, similar to the way in which these objects are related to each other, not by consciousness but by attention, I am sanguine enough to hope that others may find what I believe to be there. What will be found will not be the alleged fact that consciousness is simultaneously its own object, but the actual fact that simultaneous with the obtaining of the conscious relation among objects, there is an attentional relation of this consciousness to its objects, with the result that consciousness has the same distinctive superiority over its objects, which any of these objects may at some other time have over its fellows. When this fact is found, the questions asked of realists by Mr. Lovejoy will answer themselves. End of The Relation of Consciousness and Object in Sense Perception by Evander Bradley McGilvary.